Hello and welcome. I am so excited for you all to be here. My name is Jessica Winward, and I am the programming and operations for Dream World Education. And we are so happy to have you all here joining us. What I'm going to do is I'm going to make the chat so everyone can chat. If you can just put where you're joining us from today. We want to make sure that we are celebrating the community that we're creating. And so if everyone could please write in the chat where you are joining us from, we would love to see, and we can share those out just as we begin. Let's see, we got some Los Angeles. That's also where I am. Hollywood, El Monte, Minneapolis, amazing. Echo Park, I love it, welcome. Got LA, Santa Monica, Westside, Arizona, NoHo, Trinidad, El Monte, Iowa, Santa Monica, Tarzana. Oh, we have so many wonderful folks here. Encino, Laguna Woods, San Francisco, from Brentwood, Brooklyn. Amazing. Oh my goodness. We have the gambit all across the country. We're so happy to have you all here. Welcome and thank you. So as we get started, I just want to share just some optimal viewing instructions. So if y'all can see, during the presentation, we're gonna ask that you stay muted and have your cameras off just so we can focus on the incredible art that you're gonna be seeing. We also recommend that you are in side-by-side speaker view. So if you're like, where is that? If you look just right above where I'm pointing, like right over here, if you hit view, you should be able to hit side-by-side speaker view. And if you're like, whoa, Jessica, you're very small, you can take those two lines with that this red arrow is pointing to, and you should be able to drag it and match the size for your viewing pleasure. All right, if you're having any challenges or problems with that in the chat, you are welcome to reach out. We have someone called Tech Help, the wonderful and incomparable Michelle. So if you are having any problems, feel free to message our Tech Help and they will be there to help you in every way that we can. And without further ado, I have the pleasure of introducing the amazing Dr. Hughes. So I'm going to replace my spotlight and let that be Dr. Hughes. Thank you.
Hi, welcome everyone. We are so happy to have you all here today. And you know, and we're so honored to have Johnny Simmons and Halima Taha with us. I'm Dr. Sheila Hughes, a proud board member. Now, you know, I grew up in the inner city of Cleveland during the tumultuous 60s. And for me, learning, character, and art were always so important. You know I am who I am today because of programs like Dream of World Education. And that's why I'm a board member, to make sure that other children have the same opportunities than that, you know, that I was given. Bunny Hull, our executive director, is a Grammy award-winning songwriter and singer, and the song that I know her best for is New Attitude by Patti LaBelle. I'm sure some of you remember that one too. So Bunny transitioned from her primary work as an artist in early 2000s to help change the course of children's lives, and she has done it dramatically so. So I have the pleasure of introducing you to our founder and our executive director, Bunny Hull.
Thank you, Dr. Hughes. And I want to thank all of you for being here and thank our board staff, our board chair, Diane Cabot, our event committee, Cora Muirhead, Leslie Friedman, and Dr. Hughes, Jessica Winward, and Michelle Mehring for their work to make this possible today. I founded Dream of World Education in 2008 after a long career in music and the arts, because I became aware that so many children, especially those in early elementary grades in underserved areas, were not getting to explore who they were and the world around them in a way that only the arts provide. So we created a program called Secrets of the Heart. It's an arts-based social-emotional learning program with an emphasis on culture and diversity. It introduces children 4 through 8 to universal values through multicultural arts experiences delivered by 13 diverse professional artists. And it teaches children that who they are matters, that they are somebody. It teaches them that we're all connected. And most recently, we've introduced a new anti-bias curriculum into our programs to support exploration of the social justice standards that are created by the Southern Poverty Law Center. And it's so important for children at this age. Now, I've known Johnny Simmons since the late 1970s, and I'm so proud to call him my friend. His heart is as big as his talent. Or maybe it's the other way around. His heart is what makes his talent so big. Anyway, it's in great part because of his generosity in making possible the filming of our Secrets of the Heart opening performance that we're now able to offer our 27-week web-based hybrid program, Secrets of the Heart TV, to children in schools in underserved areas outside of Los Angeles, including 8 other states and as far away as Hong Kong and South Africa. And we're just getting started. To tell you a little bit about Johnny, Johnny started his photojournalism career in the 1960s in Chicago with a camera he borrowed from a photographer friend. He's now an Emmy Award-winning cinematographer and vice president of the American Society of Cinematographers, but some of his most loved work are the brilliant black and white photos that document images of the world around him, and you'll see those here today. Halima Taha is a new family member, a new friend, and an arts professional who has contributed to the world of art and academia for over 30 years in diverse capacities, including gallery owner, fine art appraiser, curator, art advisor, adjunct professor, researcher, professional speaker, author, arts and education liaison, public program specialist, and arts management consultant. She's best known for her groundbreaking bestseller, Collecting African American Art, Works on Paper and Canvas, which was the first book to validate collecting fine art, prints and photography by Americans of African descent as an asset and commodity within the art market. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to both of you. Johnny, we're so honored to share your work today.
Hey, Bunny, those are some mighty kind words. And I just love you so much. We've been friends for a long time. We've done a lot of stuff together. Thank you, Bunny, for having me here. And it's so good to see you, Halima, who I've known forever as well.
It's so good to see you as well. And thank you, Bunny, for inviting me to participate in this really meaningful evening that we're about to have and also to support Dream a World. Before we begin, though, I have to say, Johnny, you know, I've known you for a very long time, and I've worked with a lot of different artists, and we all know that many visual artists make great work, but not all of them are good human beings. and so it's, you know, you have consistently been such a genuine, sincere, ethical, person whose generosity of spirit to all who come in contact with you is really noteworthy. And so it's particularly meaningful to be here to talk to you about your photography, because the photography and you as a person are really special. So I just wanted to say that. Plus, I'm just happy to see you.
Thanks a lot, Halima. You know I love you, so that goes without saying.
So we have a lot of wonderful work to look at and to talk about. And I'd like to, before we start looking at images, just ask you to start to talk about, I just want to ask you about Chicago. I'd like you to paint a picture of what the culture was like for you growing up on the south side of Chicago before you picked up a camera. And in general, and the photographs that you did see that led you to want to take pictures of the world around you.
Well, you know, when I was a young kid, it was very strange, and just destiny always has its place. My father, who was a pretty successful businessman in Chicago. He was born in 1902. He was 20 years older than my mother. I gotta stop for a minute, because I was doing a collage and it has Harriet Tubman in it. And I did the math on Harriet Tubman. And my father was like 12 or 13 years old when she died. That was just kind of way off to me. But okay. So my father used to give me art supplies. I mean, this cat was, you know, he was a nice man. He was a pretty streetwise cat. You know, he had a couple of, you know, numbers operations and liquor stores. And it was just kind of odd that he would give me these art supplies. And I always loved creating pictures and images. And I wasn't that good in sports, you know, and things like that, although I would try. And Chicago itself at that time was a seriously segregated environment. I mean, every big street introduced a new culture with no dissolves in between. It was like you'd cross State Street and it'd be white, you know, and you cross the next busy street and it'd be a different version of that, Italians or something, right? So my community was very embracing and everybody was pretty much like an extended family. And that was a good place to grow up. My mother, she was educated and had been to college. So she made it a point to expose my sister and I to different cultural events. We would go and watch the Chicago Symphony Orchestra rehearse and hear Leontine Price sing and, you know, go to museums and come back and make reports in the kitchen. And my father, because of the stuff he did, you know, he would take me to the racetrack. I'd sit up in gambling houses until I fell asleep in a chair and wake up at 9 o'clock or get burned by a cigar ash accidentally sleeping on a couch or something. And it was a nice balance, you know, it was a nice balance to have that because it gave me a real appreciation for being in the streets and I loved it, you know, from running with my father. And I also embraced all the cultural activities that my mother shared with me. And I was always involved in the arts. So when I went to school, it was interesting because I went to a private elementary school and I was there with Louis Singstack, who was my best friend. And his family owned the Chicago Daily Defender newspaper. And Louis and I would sleep at each other's houses all the time. And he had a brother, an older brother named Bobby. And Bobby was somebody we looked up to. And Hyde Park is where they lived. It was a pretty hip artistic community. And we'd hide under a pool table while Bobby and his boys would talk, you know, and smoke. And Herbie Hancock was his good friend and he'd be there in the room and we'd stay there. And when they would leave, we'd get out of the room and pretend we were them, you know? And we'd pick up the roaches from the herb and pretend we were smoking it and shooting pool. And but it was a very interesting thing because Bobby had a dark room. So I was always fascinated by that dark room and fascinated by the jazz that came out of there. And at home, you know, I painted and ran the streets and, you know, loved drawing and things like that. And then one day, man, I was in the dark room and I saw that picture come out of the developer and I just fell in love with it. I just loved that whole thing. And I would spend time with Bobby in the dark room and he didn't want to be bothered with me and Louie then, right? He was probably about 10 years older than us. And eventually I went to the National Negro Publishers Convention with them. And I was like 15 years old. Louis was there, we were together. And Bobby let me borrow his camera. I told him I wanted to take some pictures and he gave me a camera because he had all these Nikons hanging off of him. I shot a roll of film and we got back to the Defender to develop it. He said, "Dad, man, you got an eye." And shortly after that, he introduced me to the Sweet Fly Paper Life. And I knew that's what I wanted to do because it was so representative of my community. And, you know, they were candid pictures and I just had an affinity towards that book. And then he went on to introduce me to other photographers, Ernest Cole from South Africa, Gordon Parks. And there were so many dynamite photographers in our community. There was a guy named Abernathy, they called him Naps. and he was amazing. He would even make his own photographic paper. Roy Lewis was there. Who else? Roy Lewis, Billy Abernathy.
Billy Abernathy.
Yeah, you know Billy's work?
Yes, I do.
Yeah, In Our Terribleness, he has a book with Leroy Jones. I mean, I'm a Baraka. So check it out. Naps and Bobby told me that I may as well not take a picture if I have to crop it. So I was always trying to shoot for a full negative. And then it was probably about 4 or 5 years ago, I ordered Knapp's book, right? And all the pictures were cropped. but that exercise worked well for me because being a cinematographer, I don't get to crop, you know?
Right, right. Yeah. Well, we're about to start the slideshow. You know, you started taking your photographs in 1965 during the Civil Rights Movement, Vietnam War, Free Love, the Black Arts Movement, and 2 years into your journey, ABASI, the Organization for Black American Culture, was formed, and they created Hall of Respect, which was the first mural representing 14 designers and photographers and painters.
Oh yeah.
And that was like on the corner of what, 43rd and Langley?
43rd and Langley.
And
Bobby had pictures in that up there.
So my question to you is, what was it like shooting in the 1960s as a teenager? And as you answer that question, let's look at the first slide. Which is your favorite photograph, but
that's my favorite photograph for sure. Well, you know, it was different when in the 60s. When you took pictures, people weren't afraid of you. There was no social media out there to damage anyone's life or take your head off your body and put it on somebody else's. There was no Photoshop, you know, there were no tricks and people weren't afraid. And not only that, but being 16 years old, 17 years old, I was pretty much bulletproof. You know, you didn't have fear. You weren't inhibited in terms of putting the camera on somebody. But Bobby was a master, and he taught me how to be stealth with a camera, and how, you know, he'd show me exercises where he'd work between the beats of life and actually be able to take pictures and nobody would see him. And I guess he was a good instructor because I kind of got that down a little bit. So many of us have it down. There's like so many wonderful photographers that, you know, practice and exercise their craft in that very stealth way.
But this photograph took, you were taking pictures for 2 years. This was taken in 1967, called Christmas Eve Chicago, right?
Yeah, but you know, I'm gonna tell you something.
Tell me.
The time frame of working with the camera, I don't know if it's that important because I picked up that machine and I could see through it. I could actually frame and understand that thing. My buddy Frank Stewart said something one day. He's an amazing photographer. I love him. He's my brother. Frank Stewart was talking about how photography is a very mature art form, where all the different elements that you want to put into drawing, like perspective and spatial relationships, are already inherent in the machine. You just have to apply them in the right way. And I love it. You know, I've shared that with so many people. So when I picked up a camera, I pretty much felt like I could see. You know, I felt like it was something that I could do. And I'm telling you, at the time, it was very important to do that because, you know, there aren't many role models growing up in Chicago in the 60s and running the streets. And to find myself in the arts was very important. I tried to play a horn. You know, I did all kinds of things. And Bobby turned me on to photography. And it just became a compass that has navigated my life all the way up until today. But this photograph is called Christmas Eve, and it's taken in front of Carson Perry Scott department store. And that's a reflection of the woman in the herringbone coat that you're seeing in a mirror. On the exits of the store, there were these diagonal mirrors that came out. And that's her image being reflected. And that little girl, I mean, it's like religious to me. It looks like, you know, a religious image to me. And something else Bobby said that always rang true was a photograph has to have a soul. it has to have a ghost in it. It's got to have a spirit, something that really speaks to people, that really touches them, has its energy within it. And that's how I feel about this photograph. Although reality of it is she's probably just asking her mother, why can't I get that doll we just saw, you know?
Exactly.
Right? But
let's look at the next photograph, Dance Chicago, 1967.
Yeah, that's in some club in Chicago. And I probably was with Bobby that day because he would take me to all these sets where they were playing jazz and stuff. And that photograph says something now different than it said then, because this woman, she's white, the guy's black, and she's totally relaxed in his arms. And my man is on the lookout, because you don't know where something is gonna come from. It could come from a member of the club, anything could happen. A cop could walk in there. Anything could happen at that time to interrupt that moment. And yeah, that's about it.
Let's look at the next image of the Blackstone Rangers in Chicago.
Yeah, that's a Reverend C.T. Vivian in the middle, sitting at the table. And I was covering an assignment for the Chicago Defender, and the Blackstone Rangers were announcing that they had become a religious organization called the El Rukins, and they wanted to be, you know, respected in the community as that. And, you know, the newspaper was there. I wish I had the other photograph that's with it, because on the other side, what they're looking at is a whole room full of reporters. And it's because it's the 60s, what's really funny is that these brothers that are so hard looking have on like paisley pants and stuff like that, because it's the 60s, you know, bright flowered colored pants, and it's pretty funny. But that didn't last very long, because shortly after that, the leader of the organization got caught trying to negotiate for a rocket launcher on a cell phone, on a phone in the jail. So that kind of blew that image out the window.
So let's go to the next image, Funeral, 1973.
Oh, wow, yeah, that's Nashville, Tennessee. And I actually followed a motorcycle club to this funeral. And that photograph, actually, you know, most of the photographs we're looking at were in a fire. Like my favorite photograph, Christmas Eve, was restored from a print that a friend of mine had. And this one just recently was sent to me by somebody as a scanned print, because this negative no longer exists. But yeah, it's a funeral in Nashville, Tennessee.
Well, speaking of Nashville, Tennessee, I know that I'd like to just talk a little bit about your time at FISC, how you got there, Dave Driscoll and Carlton Moss.
You know, that was an interesting thing that I have to also be grateful to Bobby, because, you know, when we were young, we had Louis, my friend Max Feynman, and a couple more of us used to hang out together, and we all had dropped out of high school. We were trying to find self-realization through self-destruction. We were doing everything we possibly could. It was the 60s, right? And Bobby got an invitation to be an artist in residence at Fisk University by Mr. Driscoll. And he sent my portfolio down there because he wanted me to come down and be his assistant, because, you know, that's what I was doing for him at the Defender for a long time. And I had to go to an evening school, an adult evening school, and get my high school diploma. And whatever, it was called Central YMCA. So I got that diploma pretty quick. I think it took like 3 months to get a high school diploma. I found the place on the back of a matchbook on the L train in Chicago. That's how I learned about the school. And Bobby takes me down to Nashville, Tennessee. And David Driscoll, I'm forever grateful to him. I miss him a lot. I used to speak to him almost every Sunday. And David was the one that got me the scholarship to Fisk and got me in there. And while I was there, Bobby and I built dark rooms. We built two of them. He gave me a room where I had my own private dark room, which was really nice. And we taught classes there. And in the process of that, Carlton Moss is an amazing cat. Carlton used to be Paul Robeson's road manager. He was Lena Horne's road manager. And he was also very close with W.B. Du Bois. And he would spend time with him and stay at his house. He taught me some interesting things. He said that when he lived at Du Bois's house, Du Bois said that if you can't tell people what it is you're talking about in 15 minutes, then the conversation has gone too long, right? And although Carlton would stay at his house, he would have to make an appointment with Dr. Du Bois. And 15 minutes was up, he'd get up and go do something else, right? So when Carlton was in Nashville teaching this course called The Image of the Black Man in American Cinema. And we would watch, you know, the class would start off with Birth of a Nation, and then we would watch Claudine and Guess Who's Coming to Dinner, you know, whatever was out and we're talking about, we would talk about that. And then one day, Carlton saw my photographs and he said, "You're a cinematographer." I didn't even know what a cinematographer was. I hadn't heard the word before. And he began to send me a subscription to American Cinematographers magazine. And he had a friend that sent me an Aeroflex and some film, which I messed up a lot of it before I could get it together. And one day I was in my little $50 a month apartment, and Usman Sambini, who is the father of African cinema, came to Nashville to show this film called The Money Order and another film called Black Girl. And he was amazing. And he had an interpreter with him all the time. She was a French woman. And all of a sudden one morning, there's a knock on my door. And you know, it wasn't a very good idea to surprise a college kid in the morning, because no telling what was out, right? And it was Usman Sambini, Carlton Moss, and the interpreter at my door. And they all came into my house, which the living room was also the kitchen. And it was in an alley, right? And Carlton said, "Show them your photographs." And I showed them to both of them. And he said the same thing. And I was like, man, what is this cinematographer thing, right? Shortly after then, Carlton made a movie, a training film in Nashville, Tennessee. And I remember looking through that movie camera for the first time, and you'd see the shutter flickering in the eyepiece, which nobody gets to see anymore. Digital cameras don't do that. And I panned that camera and I just fell in love with it. It was like a new love altogether, looking through that movie camera. So he sent Bobby out to USC Film School to study film because they wanted to start a film department in Nashville. And Bobby came back and we started making Super 8 films. And when Bobby's time at Fisk was over, they sent me to USC on a scholarship. I got a scholarship, presidential scholarship from Fisk to go to USC, and it was presidential. So the president, Dr. Lawson, had a heart incident. And as soon as he was on the table, Fisk canceled my scholarship. But CBS Studios picked it up and I was able to continue my education in cinematography there. That was a long answer. I forgot what the hell you asked me.
Well, it's okay, it was very interesting. I just want to quickly ask you, and then we'll move on to the next image.
Okay.
Could you talk about the contrast between the culture in Nashville and Chicago? And I'll just leave it at that. Just briefly.
Well, I'm going to tell you, here's what it was like. As I told you, Chicago was a very segregated environment. And a lot of the assignments that I would get sent on as a newspaper photographer, and I had a little raggedy Volkswagen that sometimes started and sometimes didn't. And I was like, you know, going to places where schools were being integrated, and, you know, I can remember going to one day and the cops escorting me and the writer out of that neighborhood until we crossed one of those busy streets and got back to the Black neighborhood. Well, I could pretty much say that in Chicago, you'd see other cultures when you wanted to. Well, when I got to Nashville, Tennessee, it was basically the same thing. You know, you were like in this community of nothing but Black people, which, you know, was the same way in Chicago. It was an embracing environment, and it was a passionate environment. There was a lot of energy there. And not only that, but being at Fisk University was pretty amazing because it was coming to the end of the civil rights era, and everybody was there. Eldridge Cleaver's, Kathleen Cleaver was there, Farrakhan, Miles Davis, you just name it, and Romare Bearden was there, and David Driskell had every artist you can imagine show up at that place. I mean, Jacob Lawrence, you just name them, and the people were there. John Killens. Another thing that happened to me at Fisk, not long after I was there, David introduced me to Aaron Douglas. And Aaron Douglas had me help him repaint a mural. And I spent a year with Aaron Douglas repainting a mural, and him and I became really good friends. I would go over to his house and fall asleep on the couch, and we would talk, and he became a really tight partner of mine.
There's, you know, Johnny, I just want to stop you there for a second, because some people may not know who Aaron Douglas was, and Aaron Douglas was considered to be the father of the Harlem Renaissance in terms of embracing an aesthetic that was encouraged by many Black artists from 1919 to 1929, who were encouraged by Dr. Alain Locke to, they were encouraged to find their own aesthetic outside of the European Academy, and to draw and make art that reflected their life and their culture. And he was able to really successfully marry Western plastic arts with the abstract angles that that are in African art. And so I just wanted to clarify that for some people that didn't know who he was and the significance to American art history and African-American art history. And I also wanted to just interject about who David Driskell was, because David Driskell, his work was a continuation of James Porter's book and work, Modern Negro Art, which came out in 1943. And that was the first African-American art history book that established the field of African-American art history. And that was an outgrowth of his inquiry as an artist as to why the artists from the Harlem Renaissance did not receive any critical acclaim. And as you know, he was told, well, that's because Black people haven't been here long enough to have art to think about critiquing. So he decided to write the first history book. And then David Driskell built on that work, another work of necessity, and the very well-known and critical exhibition, Two Centuries of African-American Art, traveled all over the world. And it said, yes, we do have a history, but yes, we've been here for 200 years. And I think you also worked on that film, but I just wanted, for some people that don't know who these people are and what the history is, I just wanted to interject that. And also, can we go to the next slide too?
But wait a second, you have to tell people this. Sam, yes. Pollock has made a film called Black Art and the Absence of Light.
That's right.
It's on HBO right now, and it has all of the artists that Halima's talking about and more. And Frank Stewart and I worked with Carlton Moss on the movie that accompanied the exhibit, and it was called Two Centuries of African American Art. And
that's right.
I did the stills, and I did the cinematography, and the small crews, and Carlton beat us up, and we made a real piece of history. And when you see that film that Sam made, you'll see the footage that we worked on, and you'll see actually some stills that Frank shot. And you'll see Frank in it. He's in it.
He's in it.
Hey, I'm going to close this shade because it's killing my camera. Go on. Oh, this picture. Window writing. Oh, yeah.
Window writing. This is 1968.
Yeah.
You want to close your shade?
I'm going to close it.
Okay. So while Johnny closes the shade, one of the famous quotes of Frank Stewart is that photography is a medium born grown. That's the exact quote to what Johnny was referring to earlier. And the Two Centuries exhibition and the film were major pieces of history in terms of documenting Black visual culture when it came out in the 70s. So this recent film, is a really wonderful way to see how the market and the way that the work is discussed has been ushered into the 21st century. So let's talk about this wonderful photograph, Window Writing. It's 1968 is when you took this one.
Yeah, that picture is in a soul food restaurant in Chicago. It's on 71st Street. And I don't know what there's to say about this picture. You know, I love it because this young girl is making this wonderful piece of abstract art, and the man on the right is appreciating what she's doing. I don't know if it's her father or friend or whoever it is. And it's just one of those moments that, you know, feels so, there's so much love in the picture.
Yes.
Love for what she's doing and love for how he's embracing what she's doing. I just like this photograph a lot. And, you know, a lot of people really dig this picture. And when I first printed it, I was pretty surprised. You know, I hadn't shown any of my work since 1971 down in Nashville, Tennessee. And in 2016, there's a gallery called the Perfect Exposure Gallery that gave me an exhibit after a friend of mine took me there to show him my work. Armando Aricio is the owner of that gallery. And so many people are attracted to this picture. It's in a number of collections and it just speaks to a lot of people. You know, and sometimes when you ask me or anybody asks me to talk about a picture, sometimes I just feel like a picture is, you know, like a piece of music, you know, that, you know, it doesn't deserve being intellectualized.
Agreed.
One thing that Bobby told me when he was having that conversation about the ghost inside of a picture is that the picture has to be strong enough to live on a wall by itself. And that is how we have to determine whether or not to make a print of it. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I think this is one of those pictures. There's not much mm-hmm. for me to say about it, you know?
Let's move on to Tai Chi Brother, Los Angeles, 2015, the next picture.
Yeah, Tai Chi Brother. You know, I've been in love with Tai Chi a long time. So I had a Tai Chi instructor, he was Chinese, and I would meet him in the park. And it'd be early in the morning. I mean, this is probably about 6:30, you know, in the morning. We'd get there at 6 o'clock. And there was one other brother down there besides him, and he practiced martial arts with another guy, but I practiced Tai Chi. And this particular morning, I see this guy walking down the sidewalk, and he walks up to where I am, and he has a book in his hand, and it's a book that I had purchased while I was at Fisk University, a really old book on Tai Chi. And I started talking to him, and then he started practicing the form. His own form, not a form I'd ever seen before. But the tragedy of this picture is I started to see that guy quite often and he was never that guy again. I mean, he had a lot of different personalities, and because I printed this picture to give to him, I had it in my car. And then when I went up to talk to him, that isn't who he was It was an interesting experience, but I really like this picture, you know. I printed it really big a few weeks ago. It's really powerful when it's like 36 inches, you know.
Let's look at the next image, boy with a cannon.
That was taken down in Trinidad. I was down there making a movie. And it's just at this historical site in Trinidad. And once again, it's just a picture we have to appreciate for what it is, you know. I don't know what there is to say about
it. And the next image, Angel on Melrose, 2019.
You know, this is an interesting picture because I was actually driving down Melrose and I went around the block. And usually if you do something like that, the people are gone. That's the difference between shooting pictures in cities where people are close together, like being in New York or being in Chicago. You know, you could take pictures all day, you see them all day. In LA, destiny plays a real part in you meeting these images and being at the right place in the right time. So I parked my car around the block and walked over there and shot a few pictures. And the interesting thing about it is that this particular day, at the end of the day, the light came through the trees and illuminated that area where that woman is. Mm-hmm. And it's the only time that it could do that. The next day, that sun doesn't come through and hit those wings that way, right?
Right.
And I shot that picture. I think I shot like 3 frames. And then I walked up to the guy and I wanted to show him the picture. I said, because I wanted to give it to him, you know, to find out who they were and email it to him or something, right? And I walked up to him and I said, hey man, I just took an interesting photograph of you guys. And he turned and he just did like this, I'm not interested. I was like, okay.
Thought it was for sale. Let's move to the next one, which is Nazi.
Yeah, Nazi. You know, I have a little camera. It's a Panasonic XL100. It's small. It's got a 24 to 75 millimeter lens on it. It's a digital camera. And it fits in my pocket, right? So I heard that a white supremacist organization was having an event on the steps of City Hall. And it was also Hitler's birthday. And that's why they were doing it. So I got on the subway and I rode down there. There was a lot going on, you know, a lot of stuff was happening. And I'm not really into, you know, crowds and stuff. So I walked over there and shot a couple of pictures. And then I'm standing behind this brother with this Martin Luther King t-shirt on. And he turns and I take this picture. And when I took that picture, I left after that. I felt like this picture said everything. There wasn't another picture down there left to take, you know? And the cops had fenced off the Nazis, so we couldn't really see them. There was a big fence with fabric, plastic on it, so you couldn't even see them on the steps of City Hall. And when they left, they ushered them out a different way. I saw that on the news. Nobody ever confronted these people because they were out of touch. But yeah, that photograph, I shot a couple of frames that day and, you know, left.
Let's go to the next image, which is Cotillion, Los Angeles.
Oh yeah, this is.
Oh my gosh.
This is like a time travel picture. It looks like Count Basie or Duke Ellington are gonna walk into that crowd, you know? And it's the Lynx Cotillion, right? Cotillion. And a friend of mine, Ian Fox, who's a really good photographer, and he was doing videos for the Lynx. You know what the Lynx are, right? It's like a black, sophisticated organization that's really old, you know, bourgeois organization. And that's a coming out event for their daughters, right? And he called me up. He says, Johnny, my cameraman just boned me. He's not gonna show up. And I need somebody to shoot for me. He says, do you know anybody who wants to make $100. I said, well, what is it? He said, it's the Lynx Cotillion. I said, I'll do it, because I knew I would get there and I would see these beautiful Black people all dressed up, right? And those steps are paper. They're not real at all, right? And they do the father and daughter dance. And I was operating a video camera, and I locked that thing off, and I picked my camera up and shot this picture. And you know, if you put your hand over the people with the cell phones, it just turns into the 40s, you know what I mean? And it's a good picture. It's in a few museums, this picture.
Yeah, it's absolutely beautiful. Let's go to the next image, Degas, 2016 in Los Angeles.
Yeah, that picture is, Debbie Allen has something called the Hot Chocolate Nutcracker. Mm-hmm. And these were those are little girls actually. And they're coming out of the wings to hit the stage and do their performance. It has the same strange quality about it because I shot it with a digital camera. So it kind of artifacts the hands and the feet. But it reminds me of those Degas paintings.
Yeah.
And that's why I call it that.
Let's go to the next image, Dump Trump, 2016.
That was at an anti-Trump rally.
Really? And,
yeah, of course. Surprise, surprise, right? But it was at an anti-Trump rally, 2016. And I just looked up and that cat was hanging on the light pole and I shot the picture.
And the next image, Caravaggio, London.
So I was in London, Tim Reed and I, the actor, director Tim Reed, who I made my first feature film with, called Once Upon a Time When We Were Colored. He's a good friend of mine, right?
That was, by the way, the way you shot that film, it looked like the lighting and everything was like a Edward Hopper painting.
Yeah, I was, you know, influenced by those styles, that's for sure. It's got Hopper, Caravaggio, and Vermeer.
Yep.
Those are the painters that influenced that look. But Tim and I were in London teaching classes at the British Film Academy. And the Muslim people, you know, were there. And at that time, there was so much static being thrown at them because of their wardrobe. I wanted to take some photographs that showed them in society with people and living, right? So, that's in front of the National Gallery. And that thing in the back is a vinyl poster announcing a Caravaggio exhibit that's opening. And we see Yoda, who's levitating as a street vendor. And I was there looking at him and I look to the right and there's this big group of Muslim people. And I'm just keeping my fingers crossed that they're gonna cross my frame so I can get them, right? And I just looked down for a second. And when I looked back up, they were right at the edge of the frame. And the photograph did everything that I wanted it to do.
Yeah, it certainly does.
Put them there. You know, a lot of people think that picture is photoshopped.
No.
But it's not.
It's not. Let's look at the next image, LACMA.
Oh yeah, this geometry. The geometric patterns in this picture, that's a sculpture that's in the lobby that connects the two galleries together. And, you know, Aaron Douglas, one of the things that he would get excited about was the whole idea of the golden mean and the divine proportion. And him and I would walk around and he would show me that in a tree, or we would look at a flower, the spiralic pattern of the of a sunflower, and he would talk about that. And, you know, we quite naturally are attracted to that proportion. And he'd talk about how little children intuitively draw that way, a big house and a little family, a big family and a little house. And it's always a little more than half, a little less than half. And then when they get to be about in the fourth grade, everything begins to change and becomes really intellectual. So this picture just does that for me, you know? Right. And I don't, I don't know if that statue's still there.
Let's look at the next image, Checking Teeth, 2005.
Yeah, my wife Cynthia titled that picture. That's in Trinidad. It's at a soccer stadium. And that little girl looks like she's checking teeth or working a typewriter. A typewriter repair shop.
And let's look at the next image, Alejandro Santiago in Mexico.
Oh my God, Alejandro. I taught at UCLA for 26 years. Mm-hmm. There was a student, she was from Mexico, and she didn't identify with the majority culture. Like everybody who came to UCLA would always have like some girl running down a beach with her hair blowing in the wind and some Adonis looking guy running towards him and some field of daisies, those kind of images. And Yolanda was always very distant to that. And the next year that I came home and I told Cynthia, I said, there's a girl in my class that totally appreciates her culture. Because I was always a little disappointed when someone would come from like Vietnam or Africa and they would try to copy these Western images. But Yolanda didn't do that. And she turned out to be my TA the following year and we became friends. And it turned out that she was making these documentaries with very inexpensive cameras, flying down to Mexico and filming people whose families had crossed the border illegally and suffered the consequences of those things. And she comes to my house 2 years later and she shows me this movie that she's been working on. And it's heart-wrenching. And she turns around and she's crying. And she says, the dean of the documentary department is gonna fail me. I said, don't cut one frame out that movie. She said, can you help me? I said, well, I'm only at UCLA on Saturdays. I don't know anybody, but we'll figure something out. Shortly after that, she was given a fellowship by like the American Federation of the Arts or something. And they introduced her to Alejandro, who had crawled across the desert and to experience what it was like to do that. And these statues represent 2,005 people who have left his village. And whoever gave Yolanda the fellowship gave him the fellowship. And he made these statues. And that man is carrying that statue to lay down on the ground to label it for shipping. It's for an installation that opened in Monterrey, Mexico. It's called 2005 Migrants. And if you look it up on the internet, you'll be blown away because Alejandro is just so incredible. And if you just give me one more second, I want to say something. Him and I hit it off very well. The first day I met him, we drank mezcal. And soon after that, I could speak fluent Spanish and he could speak fluent English. And we became the best of friends. And he picked me up one morning.
Just one drink, huh? Just one sip. Right.
He picked me up one morning. I got in his van. And a day and a half later, with no toothbrush, no change of clothes, because I didn't know where we were going, we go to a village that has no running water, it has no electricity, and it's where he was born. And the fact that he comes from this cave and winds up here, and he's Christo's friend, and his paintings are 20 feet by 20 feet, and he's an amazing artist. And he died a couple of years ago. And he gave me one of those statues too. I have one of a child, you know, but yeah.
Johnny, I have a question from someone. Did you use Lightroom to create the effect and when you were printing in the darkroom?
You know, I did use Lightroom and Photoshop, but I have to admit, I don't know very much about either of those things, you know? Mm-hmm. I'm not that good at it. So more than anything, it's a lot of contrast going on. Mm-hmm. And in Lightroom, I kind of sharpened it up a little bit. But Yeah, it's one of my poor attempts at Lightroom. And it's also shot with my little Panasonic, you know? I have my Sony down there and I have my Leica, but I'm shooting a movie at the same time. I have the exact same frame in the film that I was shooting.
I don't mean to cut you off. We have 3 minutes before we have an open question and answer. And we have three more photographs that I really would like people to see. Okay. The next one is Bull Ride, Costa Rica, 2014. Yeah. And if you can, and the next one is Mask, 2017, in Los Angeles.
Those are some strange flicks. The Bull Ride is, we were in Costa Rica, my family, we were taking a vacation, and we stayed at not a bed and breakfast, but an Airbnb. And these two young people were lawyers, and the lawyer actually represented the guy who puts on this event. And he takes me there and he says, and the next thing I know, I hear my name, John Simmons, Hollywood, blah, blah, blah. And everybody starts clapping. And they make me go down into the bull ring, right? And wave at people. I don't know what it was about, right? And while I was down there, what these guys would do, their idea of a rodeo is they would touch the bull, and whoever touched the bull the most times got to ride the bull. And I tell you, I shot two frames, this one and the next one, that dude was on his head, right? And that rope looks like it has something to do with the bull, but the guy is actually opening the gate with it. And this is another poor attempt at Photoshop and Lightroom, but yeah.
Okay. And then the next one was Mask, but the final one before the question and answer after this is Friends. And it's and I thought it was an appropriate way of closing because of just the fact that wherever you go, you make new friends. And It's just a nice image.
Yeah, it's on my street in Nashville, Tennessee, where I was living. And that one of Mask, I was actually there watching a film that Billy Woodbury made on about a poet. I can't remember his name right now. And that was happening in the parking lot. That thing, that lady with the mask on and the guy laying on the ground, and there were lowrider cars, and it was just a very strange event. I don't know what was really happening, right? But it's not like you think. That guy is not dead, and that person right. is not a terrorist. You know, it's like.
You know, Johnny, I have known you for a long time, and you have always had a very active, inquisitive, interdisciplinary mind. What continues to captivate you about photography and film?
Well, I have to tell you something. It's like, I'm 70 years old now. I turned 70 in December. And when I wake up in the morning, I wake up with the same curiosity that I've always had, you know, and it gives me energy to do everything that I do. And, you know, once you start having an art form that you love, and that thing is based on passion that you do, that motivates you with it. It just never goes away, you know? I love taking pictures today as much as I ever did. And I carry a camera every day. I don't take pictures every day. I wait for certain things across my path that attract my attention and I have an affinity for, and that's how it works. But that's what happens, you know, it's just that curiosity and that excitement and the fact that there's no end to it. I mean, when you're an artist, you're continually in a state of becoming. You're not arriving at anything, you know, and every day you wake up a brand new person, and every time you press the shutter, you're expressing the totality of every experience you've ever had in life. And I don't think that goes away. It doesn't go away in the film business for me. It doesn't go away with still photography. And I suppose it's like that with all artists that are in love with stuff, you know?
Mm-hmm. You have two exhibitions of your work up. Could you tell us about them?
Oh, I have an exhibit up right now at this place called Casa 0101. And it's in East Los Angeles. And the curator of that exhibit is a guy named Jimmy Centano. And it's in a Spanish-speaking community. I used to have a studio there where I'd do my painting. And Jimmy asked me to put the work in there a long time ago, but I've been very busy. And due to the pandemic, I was able to take some time and get it up. And the other exhibit, which hasn't been opened, is an exhibit that is at the Getty Museum. And I only have a couple of photographs in there. And it's a protest exhibit. And my good friend and master, no joke, Adra Collins, he has a piece in there too. It's a really wonderful piece, Malcolm X. And Leonard Freed is there, Dorothea Lange, all these photographers that nurtured my growth as I was coming along. And they've had a couple of dates that they wanted to open, but it hasn't happened yet because they want it to actually be open to the public and not be virtual.
That's great. That's great. And I hope people who can get to see these exhibitions will take advantage of that opportunity to do so. I have another question with regard to, well, on one hand, it's how does your work as a cinematographer impact your photographic practice? And then also, someone has asked, is it typical for cinematographers to also take photographs? So there's...
You know, I'm in the organization, the American Society of Cinematographers, we have a photography committee that puts on an exhibit once a year of cinematographers that take still pictures. And I was quite amazed that not very many still cinematographers take still pictures. I'll tell you, I have, here's what happens. When I get ready to shoot for a network or a studio, by the time you see my work on the screen, and this is true just about for any cinematographer, it's a collaboration between the writer, the director, the producers, if there's a studio involved, the studio, the art director, all kinds of people come together to decide how to express those words on a page. And when I go to work, I have to best be able to interpret that thing visually with lighting and camera movement and composition. And nowadays, there's a video monitor present that's an actual representation of what it is that you're doing. And all kinds of people are making comments about that. And you're racing against a clock, you're racing against a budget, and you know, that's the world that I work in. When I pick up a still camera, there's nobody there to tell me anything. I get to do it. I take the picture, I move to the left, to the right, nobody, it doesn't mean anything, you know? And, you know, what do you say, kids say? They're not the boss of me. When
right.
I
You're not the boss of me.
You're not the boss of me now, right? But you know, I'll tell you something. Alonzo Davis gave me an artist in residence at the Brockman Gallery in the 70s. And it was based on my collages, which I still continue to do. And during that period, I was making a lot of music videos. I made lots of music videos, rap videos. I made them in New York, Chicago, France, all over the place. And during that period, I was so absorbed in that movie camera and the fact that once again, I was working in an arena that people left me alone because music videos and artists, that hadn't married officially yet, you know? So I was able to stretch out. And, you know, as long as you gave them 6 seconds worth of good footage, every time you turned on the camera, you could make a music video. Mm-hmm. So I didn't take very many photographs during that period. You don't see any dates for that late 70s, early 80s, because I was just so absorbed in the continuum of composition and, you know, the movie camera. And I'd go back in my studio and I'd make these collages and thank God to Alonzo Davis, because at the time he gave me that artist in residence, I needed a roof over my head. It was one of those periods.
Yeah, we all have them.
Right.
I find it I want to ask you a question about how you balance being a participant and an observer as a photographer.
You know, I'll tell you, I kind of feel like, I'm sure it's like this for all of us. I feel like the universe puts us in the right place at the right time. And I feel like my subjects and I are supposed to meet and we're supposed to have that moment. And we're supposed to share that. And it allows me to be able to share it with you. And I can't create those moments. I was in little Tokyo in Los Angeles, driving around the block, trying to find a parking space on a Friday. Traffic is heavy. And finally I park. And when I park my car, I'm right in front of this building. And the building says, on a marble wall, Federal Bureau of Humanity. No, Federal Bureau of Human Resources. Mm-hmm. And underneath that sign, fitting perfectly in a 50 millimeter frame, is a homeless person laying on the ground.
Hold on a second. Jesse, could you go to show us the federal public, federal public defender image that you're talking about?
Oh, we have it?
Yeah, we do. There it is.
I mean, nothing but destiny could create that moment, you know? And it's that way with pretty much all my pictures. You know, I mean, you just, even the angel on Melrose, it's like, you know, we're supposed to meet each other. I'm supposed to share this picture. It's supposed to be as much yours as it is mine. And this right. had to happen. So in terms of being a witness and an observer, I'm doing that all day. You know, I don't ever stop doing that. It becomes a download. As a cinematographer, I have to recreate ideas, emotions, and paint those things with light and camera. So all day long, I'm downloading stuff. And I do it unconsciously. I put a reel together, a demo reel together. And I looked at a lot of scenes in different films that I shot. And I found artwork that totally matched those things. And at the time, I wasn't trying to do that. It's just that going to the museum, study paintings, study books on photography, studying art becomes nutritional. It just becomes part of your DNA. And you begin to have that as a reference when you put things together. I work with a cat. He was a really good dude. His name was Edwin. He was my gaffer for a long time. And he had the same interests as I did. And I'd have to send him ahead to get scenes to light a room because we'd be on a tight schedule. Johnny, what's this going to feel like? I said, it's Caravaggio, man. Take the ambient light away. And I'd get in there and light would be coming through a single source. Or, you know, we're doing a Vermeer, baby. We got to put a little diffusion on that and black out the wall behind us, you know, and right. you know, he could take that information and go with it. So I feel like being an observer is influenced by all the photographers I study, by the art I study, all that stuff, you know, even the music that you listen to, you know?
Well, yeah, I wanted to ask you about that. I'm gonna ask you two more questions. And, you know, okay. I know that music has played a very important role in your consciousness as a photographer. Can you recall the soundtracks that you remember in different, you know, periods? You know, I know it runs the gamut, you know, with Otto Brown Jr., AACM, Chicago Art Ensemble, Coltrane.
Yeah, I mean, you know, all of us have a soundtrack to our lives. You know, we take a picture or we live, we have a memory. There's a sound that goes with it. It's so unfortunate that nowadays, music and imagery is so disposable and so temporary. I don't know how the soundtrack plays in a lot of young people's lives. Maybe it plays per incident. But when I was growing up, Summer in the City by Oscar Brown was Summer in the City. You know what mm-hmm. I mean? You know, and A Love Supreme was A Love Supreme. And all those sounds, you know, resonate with experiences and times and places. And you know, you can just see it, man. You could see cats walking down the street in Chicago and you could almost guess what song was playing in their head, you know? And of course it has influenced the way all of us see things and experience love and sadness, you know? I'll come home and put on some Frankie Beverly. And my wife will say, well, what's wrong with you today?
What happened? Well, tell me about it. Right?
What happened today to you, right? Joy and pain. Yeah, that's a good song.
Could you just share how African masks have influenced your work?
Well, not just African masks, but African art in general. Mm-hmm. I studied African art with David Driscoll, and he would talk about form and function, you know? And that became a foundation of the narrative, to be able to tell a story and let that form have a function, and that function is what becomes important. It's the thing that lives into eternity. And I don't know if you've seen a lot of my collages, but
yes, I have.
Collages are documentaries, you know? They're not just pictures, they're documentaries. They're documentaries, that's what they are. They're stories, you know? And they take over where the photographs leave. And I mean, I'm not answering your question because I can't attribute it to the actual mask, except its function. Right. You know what I mean?
Well, yeah, I mean, there's that contrast between a Eurocentric view of art for art's sake and then an Afrocentric view of art for life's sake. You know, so and that ties to form and function. And as you're navigating whatever environment that you're in, you're making that relationship between what you're seeing and doing.
That's exactly the truth. I mean, I've never done art for art's sake. And I don't think any of my close friends do that either. All of us are speaking, you know, and all of us are taking on the responsibility as storytellers and putting it out there to make a difference and, you know, to become a part of the fabric of humanity in our work and to be able to let that be known. You know, we're inseparable from each other. And hopefully the pictures say that, and hopefully the collages say that, and they'll be around a long time, you know? And that's why I think that the image has to speak in such a way and be able to have that ghost in it and hold a room for 100 years from now when nobody's around and you walk up on Federal Public Defender, mm-hmm. It's gonna tell you a story, you know?
Yes, yes. There's so many more images of yours that, you know, I would love to talk about and share with everyone that's here with us. But I just want to thank you so much for being who you are and making these statements that invite people to reflect upon themselves and the world in which they live. And also, I just want to thank you for inviting me to have this conversation with you.
I'm so glad. I'm so glad that we did this, and I'm so grateful to Bunny and, I mean, all the people that took the time out to look at the pictures and hear us talk. And, you know, I just hope that, you know, everybody got something out of it. I'm just glad to do it.
Yeah, I am too. Well, I'd like to ask Bunny to come join us.
Hey, Bunny. How are you? Oh, I don't hear you, Bunny.
There I am. There you are. So rich, Johnny. I mean, your art is so powerful. Your photographs are so powerful. And you gave me this quote, in life, you have to be careful. In art, you don't. This was in response, by the way, to me asking you why the arts was important for children. And in life, you have to be careful. In art, you don't. Art is the time you spend in the boundless. When you make art, you can share everything you are. That so profound.
It's still really funny because just like I said earlier today, when I read it, I kind of look at it and say, damn, I said that, you know? but it's true. I mean, really, you know, and that's why it's so important for children to be able to have those creative moments, whether it's music, whether it's dance, whatever it is, where you get to actually express who they are. They can reach inside themselves, and for that time that they do it, you know, you're free. There's no limitations to how fast you can move, how slow you can move, how bright the red is, and it contrasts with the color. And no, that doesn't belong together, but it does, you know what I mean? And, you know, you frame a picture and with your camera and the head is at the bottom of the frame and, you know, the rest of the space is empty space and nobody's there to stop you. And as you grow up and you live, you're continually being confronted by things that hold you back. But the other thing that you learn to love, if you stay involved in the arts and you're presented with difficulties and you're presented with obstacles, your passion for what you do becomes greater than any obstacle that can confront you. Yeah. And that freedom is just something that nourishes everybody. Everybody gets to have a piece of that, you know, and it speaks of a very, very deep love that we get to have as artists. And it's so important to share that and to let kids have it, because that's what makes the world better, you know?
Man, that's so true, Johnny. And that's the perfect segue, because I wanted to share with you. I thought you'd enjoy seeing this. We've got a clip of one of our students. She's a young girl. She started with us at 5 years old in Esperanza Elementary. That's a school here in LA that's near MacArthur Park. It's in the most densely populated area of LA. And she found her passion through our program. And I just like, her name's Valerie, and I'd like to share it with you and everyone.
Secrets, secrets, secrets of the heart.
I am myself, and that I need to believe in myself. Like I am someone that is good, and I don't need to think about anyone else. Like I'm myself.
And she has it pretty clear in her head, you know, that she matters to everybody, to me, to herself. And I want that thought to be for everybody, for all the kids.
Music and art makes me feel like excited and happy, because I get to learn all the stuff about it.
I am somebody!
But I think that it's good to open every child to all ideas. And that's what this program does, you know, it opens up everybody and it gives them an equal an opportunity to kind of grasp onto something.
One of my dreams I put in the vision board was like I wanted music, how to play music.
That was the first time that she let me know that she wanted to play an instrument.
The dream that I put with music actually came true, because Mr. Rumble gave me a chance to play piano.
It was actually pretty cool and pretty satisfying for her to get that chance to play the piano, you know, because she kind of saw that some dreams do come true.
That's just a little piece of what we're doing and how we're really teaching children that their dreams can come true, because some of the areas that we're in, you know, they don't look at life that way. They don't see a world of possibility, and the arts, as we all know, make that happen.
Buddy, that is so powerful. Thank you.
Oh yeah. Thank you.
Thank you so much. You can't see because we're so small, but I'm just in tears. I'm just a mess. It's great, great, great work.
Thank you so much, and I want to thank you both and for being here. I'm going to turn it back over to Sheila to give our final thank you. Go ahead, Sheila. Whoop, you have to unmute yourself.
Unmute. Okay. All right. I was so excited about listening to that and listening to do it. You all forgot. All right. Johnny and Halima, I mean, I have to tell you, that is just so amazing. And, you know, so many words of wisdom that you have. I'm busy writing all these little quotes down than that you said. So I want to thank you again, both of you, for being with us. And if any of you would like to learn more about Johnny and his work, and I really hope you do, you know, here's his website and also IG, Instagram for Johnny and for Halima, I think is there. And we should also have it in the chat. So at Dreamer World, you know, we're able to do the work we're doing because of people who understand the value of providing children, just like we saw, with these rich experiences that can change their lives. Children whose homes have been converted into makeshift classrooms and schools where teachers are looking for something to inspire them and to reinforce that, yes, they are somebody special. Part of a worldwide human family where cultures, traditions, and differences are both honored and respected. So I really hope you consider a donation to Dreamer World Education today or in the future to help bring our programs into schools and that can't afford them. And as they did for me, then to help children dream a different world, just like the little girl we just saw. So whether your donation is small or large, doesn't matter. Every dollar helps. And you can make a donation at www.dreamerworldedu.org/donate. And it should also be in the chat. So again, thank you so much then for being with us.
Bunny? Thank you so much, everybody. Johnny, Halima, I can't say it enough time how much I love you both for being here. And Johnny, yeah, such an honor to share your work with everybody.
Thank you so much. I'm so
we'll
glad
see everybody. We have the I Am an Artist series is continuing. We have two more events and we'll be letting everybody know what those are upcoming. And in the meantime, you need to be collecting Johnny's art before it gets so expensive. None of us can afford it.
That's so funny. Thanks a lot, Bunny. Thanks, Halima. Thanks, Sheila.
Johnny, thanks Sheila. Thank
everybody.
You,
Bunny. Michelle.
Bye, everybody.
Thank everyone for coming and sharing this evening with us.
Thanks, folks, for coming. All right.
Bye-bye.